the most respected member that this administration has ever had resigning, calling out the president for supporting authoritarian regimes. The wheels are coming off the bus was what one Republican said. Note, I want to note that this Republican is still saying this off the record, their name, right? Trump supporter.
So much courage.
Do you, what do you think, though, that these that this is starting to come out? The Republicans are starting to say these sorts of things.
Right. I think today is a horrifying day, Aaron, but I think it's a necessary and clarifying day as well. We learned today that the President of the United States cares more about the policy wisdom of Rush Limbaugh and Ann Coulter than he does about a the opinion of a dedicated patriot like General Mattis. That is horrifying. As you alluded to before, he's flip-flopped about whether he needs the $5 billion and whether he would sign the continuing resolution without
it. The wall
and when he got walloped by Fox News and by Rush and by Ann, who are grifters, who have been grifters off the conservative movement for years, he gets walloped by them and he turns tail and caves. General Mattis comes in and says, please, sir, reconsider, or we're hearing reporting, please reconsider this Syria move that you've taken without consultation with me, your generals, or your allies. And the man walks out and resigns. So that's what we have. Yeah. Rush and Ann, they're riding high, and people like General Mattis are on their way out the door.
Right. Ann Coulter, of course, in a radio interview, talking about the wall, saying if the president didn't go back and demand the wall, he'll have no legacy whatsoever. And then he goes back and demands the wall is what you're referring to.
Yes.
Stephen, I want to ask you, though, we now, you know, John Brennan, former head of the CIA, has been one of the most vocal former officials calling out what he believes is a moment of reckoning for this country. Okay, he's done it again and again. Tonight, tweeting about Jim Mattis. Okay, Republicans, how much longer are you going to let this farcical presidency, in quotes, continue? At a time of such political, economic, and geostrategic turbulence, both nationally and globally, are you waiting for a catastrophe to happen before acting? Disaster looms. He puts it that way, Stephen, but he's not alone. Marco Rubio is saying similar. John Kasich is saying similar. It is, you just heard Leon Panetta. It is, this is now becoming something we are hearing again and again and again. Are you worried?
Well, it's been a terrible week for Donald Trump, no question about it. I can't speak to Syria and the foreign policy issues because that's not my expertise. But look, I mean, when you talk about the wheels coming off, we've got the strongest economy we've had in 20 years, notwithstanding, you know, what's happened with the stock market.
Then why did the market go down 1,700 points in the past five trading days?
Because of this catastrophic decision by the Fed, which, by the way, Trump was right about this. He called out the Fed back in September, remember, and said this was a mistake, and he was right. And now, you know, if anybody should be resigned, if anyone should resign from office, it should be the chairman of the Federal Reserve, who made even while he was talking, the stock market went down by 600 points. It was a real disaster. Now, look, the real economy remains really strong. I mean, we still have 7 million more jobs than people.
I can't believe
he did the only thing that he could have done, even no matter what he wanted to do. Let's say, Steve, he said, you know what? I don't want to raise rates, or I want to cut rates.
He had
to go ahead and raise them because he signaled
that was
he would.
The most...
No, Stephen, hold on. The president of the United States said, you can't do it, you can't do it, you can't do it. The Fed's supposed to be independent. He forced the guy to do it.
Right.
And so that is a problem.
How did he force them to do it? Trump was the one who said it was a mistake in September, and it was a mistake, and now they've doubled down on
Trump's
a catastrophic
policy. You know, naming the guy, he can't do it, he can't do it, he can't do it. Trump should stay the heck out.
You know, Aaron, I'm not going to let Stephen hijack this conversation on a day like today and come back to the strong economy.
That
like that's all that matters. It's not a strong economy.
Country,
we watched the stock market crash.
We've seen
as the president spoke this afternoon.
Steve, stop, guys. Just by talking loudly, then nobody can hear you. Okay, Steve. So I get it. You're angry. She's talking.
I couldn't hear because she keeps talking.
But nobody can hear you because you're talking nonstop. Okay, so hold on a second.
Okay.
I simply ask you. This moment with General Mattis is an important moment for this presidency and this country.
Okay.
Do you deny that?
I'll accept that.
Okay. All right. So
I'm not a foreign policy person. I'm talking about the economy.
Right, but you know this president. You know the people around him. You know that he went out tonight on Twitter and he said the guy was going to retire, which was a blatantly
false.
He
lied again.
Why, Steve, do you actually think the president thought that people would believe him and that maybe nobody would see Jim Mattis's letter?
Look, I can't say. I just don't know about that. But what I'm saying is, that when it comes to the two issues that I do know about, which is the bad
Steve,
decision
that made.
But, Steve, I
don't want to talk about the economy right now for just a moment, because I want to give you a chance to talk about the president. You know him. You talked to him. I'm asking you what you think, why he thought people would believe something that he put out there that was untrue about Jim Mattis.
Look, I can't comment on that. But you brought up a minute ago the potential shutdown of the government. I'm with Trump on this. I mean, my goodness, why
shut
in the world, in a $1 trillion spending bill, can't the Democrats in Congress, who you know have a sort of a veto in the Senate, why can't they find $4 billion of a $1 trillion spending bill to build the wall when it was one of Trump's major promises? And the American people want security at the border?
It's on sale, so even though it's like a horrible item, I should buy it anyway. I'm still spending the money.
We had a referendum on this. Trump. What are you talking about? Trump ran for president. Every speech he gave, he said, I'm going to build this wall. He wins the election, and Democrats say, we're not for border security. We're not going to do this. We want catch and release. We want sanctuary states and sanctuary cities. I think Trump should take this case to the American people and say, look, I want to build a wall and secure our border. The Democrats can't find $4 billion, even though we're spending $4 billion on food stamps for illegal immigrants.
Steve. Okay, go, Joan.
You know, history is going to judge folks who made this economy argument very poorly. And if I didn't care don't interrupt me. If I did not care, if I didn't care about the people who will be furloughed over the holiday, I would say bring it on, because I really relish the idea of Democrats getting to run on a government shutdown right before Christmas. It's terrible. Your party just ran on fear of immigrants and you lost 40 seats in the House, Steve. Please, I would say bring it on, except people will suffer.
I do
so
too.
I hope the Democrats
Let's have a fight about border security. I'm with you on that. Let's have a
fight. We won the fight, as
a
matter of fact. We won
the
fight because we had an election last month and your team got its butt kicked.
Steve, I want to, you know, where the intersection of these two points are, General Mattis and the economy, right? It comes right at the heart of China and the tariffs, okay? In the letter today, Jim Mattis, right, the current defense secretary, and whether he lasts till February or not is unclear, but that's when he says he's going to stay too. Similarly, I believe we must be resolute and unambiguous in our approach to those countries whose strategic interests are increasingly in tension with ours. It is clear that China and Russia, for example, want to shape a world consistent with their authoritarian model, right? Then he goes on to continue and say, my views on this, are not the same as yours, so that is why I need to go. All right, that is clear that what the president says about China, he really means. I want to play one important thing when the president was talking about President Xi of China, okay? And a lot of people dismiss this, especially supporters, as like, oh, he's just joking. Oh, it doesn't matter. Let me just play the president of the United States.
He's now president for life.
President for life.
No, he's great. He's great. Look, he was able to do that. I think it's great. Maybe we'll have to give that a shot someday.
Steve, everybody laughed at the time. But now Jim Mattis
I couldn't hear what the president said there. So
I'll tell you what he said. He was talking about the president of China, and he said he's now president for life. He's great. Look, he was able to do that. Maybe we'll have to give that a shot someday. And everybody dismissed that. Not everybody, but people like you would dismiss that and say, oh, he was joking. But it sounds like from what General Mattis is saying is that admiration for authoritarian regimes was not a joke. It was, in fact, so serious and so sincere that the defense secretary is resigning in part over it.
What I don't get about this, and I don't know General Mattis, and I have a high respect for him. But look, Trump's staked almost his whole presidency on taking on China. It's the right time to do that. I think he has the American people behind him. If he wins this trade fight, which I believe he will because he's tough and he's not going to back down, you're going to see the biggest boom in the stock market and the economy ever. So this is I don't understand why General Mattis says somehow he's like a China sympathizer when we finally have a president who's taking on China.
We have never seen anything like this resignation letter, and it is going to reverberate, and it is going to cover over the things that Steve just said and the ways that he tried to defend the president. This is the beginning of people coming out with their critiques. You made the point earlier, people have left. People have left quietly. There's been gossip. Maybe they've talked to reporters or book writers. But no one has put their objections in a form like this for the American people to read. And I think, Steve, notwithstanding, a lot of Republicans tonight have heartburn. They are worried. And we will see more bipartisan oversight and reaction to this. And that's a good thing. Right. I think this is the beginning of accountability.
All right. Thank you both. And obviously, the breaking news here, more details. We're